Hey guys, I'm going to be showing you how to make some pancakes. I think a little bit of cross-country referencing here. Pancakes in South Africa are the really, really thin ones. I think you guys call them crepes, but whatever, we're going to do them because they're really easy. You can have them for breakfast if you want something sweet. You can kind of have them as a savory dish if you want to use them for dinner, some mince or bacon and cheese. So yeah, let's get going. So what you need is obviously a bowl, something to mix them in, something to strain them or sieve. We've got 1 cup of all-purpose flour here, which I'm going to pour into the bowl, like so. And just make sure all the lumps out. You don't want your batter to be lumpy in any way. So we're going to do all the dry ingredients first and then the wet ingredients. Right, so simple and easy. Next, we've got bicarb soda. We're going to put 1 teaspoon. This is really, really fine, so I'm not going to sieve that. So 1 teaspoon of that. 1 teaspoon of sugar. You don't want to add the sugar, I don't think you have to. And then lastly, just a pinch of salt. Salt really brings out flavor. That's why we add the salt. So I'm just gonna give that a little mix. Like so. Right, now we're going to add the wet ingredients. We've got some milk. We need 1.5 cups. So 1 cup there. Now we need 2 eggs. They don't have to be giant, just normal sized eggs. Right, and now most recipes don't say vanilla essence, but I like a little bit of vanilla essence, gives it some nice flavor. So I'm going to put 1 teaspoon in here. Not even a teaspoon. Alright, now you get your exercise for the day. When I was in varsity, we used to make these all the time. Every Saturday morning, it was a ritual with friends. They used to come over, we used to make pancakes, have some coffee, have a chat. And then whenever we couldn't think of something to do for dinner, because we didn't want to cook a whole meal, we just used to make pancakes, and whatever was left over in the fridge used to go in the pancakes. It was usually cheese. Right, now we have a nice smooth batter and we're going to heat our stove. I've just got a non-stick pan over here, which I'm going to use, and we will get to the cooking now. Okay, so we're gonna try and cook them now. I did a test one, worked out well, so your batter's obviously ready, your stove is hot. Mine's on about 7, but I don't know. Different stoves work, but here we go. So I usually put about 2 scoops of the batter in. Obviously, if you want your pancakes to be thicker, put more. Give the batter a little swirl so it covers the base of the pan. And now we leave it, right? You're going to notice that as the pancake cooks, a whole lot of bubbles appear on the surface. And when that happens, you're ready to flip it. So you can see all these little bubbles starting to appear.
Nice.
Right, pancakes done, and obviously now it's completely up to you as to what you want to put on your pancake. I've got a mixture of brown sugar and cinnamon here, so this is my pancake, so I'm gonna do a little bit of that. And I've got some caramel syrup, which I'm also gonna put on because why not, it's Friday. But you can choose the toppings that you go on, and as I said, you can do sweet, you can do savory. So these guys are really, really, really versatile. I'm gonna roll it up. That looks beautiful. All right, are we ready to go? Let's try it.
It's hot.
Hi seniors, Miss Bingham here with Adelaide and baby number two. We're gonna teach you how to make stovetop popcorn. Now when I learned this, I was well past my college years. I was probably 30 when I learned how to make this. So consider this my gift to you. So what we're gonna do is your main ingredients are, you need, Adelaide, do you wanna show the camera? You need some kernels of popcorn, okay? Then you need a big, like, soup pot, okay? It doesn't have to be this big, but kind of a big soup pot. Oh, hold on, Adelaide, we're not quite ready for that. And then you need either olive oil or butter to kind of coat the whole bottom of the pan. So I'm just gonna kind of cut off a chunk of this and then drop it in there. And then turn on the burner and let it go. Watch out, Adelaide, it's gonna be hot, okay? So something you wanna pay attention to with this is you don't wanna have the heat be on so high, because then you'll be burning your butter and then you'll be burning your popcorn. So you do need it heated and you want it melted, but you don't want it to be so hot the whole time. It can get a little intensive. Adelaide loves touching my belly, just so you all know. She was just trying to lift up my shirt, because she loves just touching my bare belly. Some fun facts for you. So the butter is slowly starting to melt, and I'm just gonna move it around to kind of coat the pan. Does this look right? It looks good? Okay. So we are gonna need to add those, but once the butter melts, okay? Can you be in charge of this? Cool. Okay, so the butter is almost melted. While we're waiting, Adelaide, can you put this into the bag? Thank you. Okay, so our butter is melted. So now what you want to make sure you do with the kernels is you want to make sure you coat the bottom of the pan with the kernels, okay? So I'm going to kind of pour. It's a really big pan, so we're gonna make a lot of popcorn. And then you kind of want to shake the pan to make sure that all the kernels are coated in the butter. Did you screw it back on?
Yeah.
Thanks, Bug. I actually am gonna pour a little bit more.
Uh-oh.
That's okay. Can you screw it on for me again, please? Oh, don't touch over here, Bug. It's really hot. Okay, so all of the kernels are coated, and now we're gonna close them. So it might be very tempting to leave and go do something else, but if you do that, you're gonna burn all of the popcorn kernels. So what you wanna do is you wanna be close to, oh, I don't think we need any more, Bug. You wanna be close to the pot, so that way you can monitor it all the time. Some toppings, salt is a usual go-to, at least for me. nutritional yeast. Thank you to Mr. Strother who told me about this. And ever since, I don't like popcorn without this. These two things, I don't want anything else. However, there are some people that like sweet popcorn. So if that's the case, you would probably put some sugar in with the butter as it's melting or with the oil. And then it would be a nice, kind of general coat for all of the popcorn, but the sugar would happen at the very beginning of the process. So over the course, you wanna just kind of move it around, make sure nothing's getting stuck to the bottom of the pan. Yeah. Okay, so we've just heard our first pop. So now I'm just giving it a little bit more of a shake to make sure that there's no popcorn kernels that are just hanging out at the bottom. And the magic is happening, people. It's happening. Oh, yep. There we go. Just spreading around some salt. You never know what's going to happen when there's a toddler around. That I can guarantee you. Something I've learned from cooking with her since being home with her all the time now is anything you don't want everywhere, you just remove from her pan. Okay, are you cleaning off the salt? Yeah. So usually when you're making your stovetop popcorn, you wanna keep listening, and when it seems like the popping has begun to fade, that is when you probably turn the heat off, and then you will remove the pan from the fire. We're not quite there yet, but it will be happening soon. Yep, this is what happens. Oh, did he get your fingers?
Oops.
Did he get your fingers? Are you okay? Okay, great. Right back at it. I might be an overshaker, but the reason that is because I kind of forgot about the importance of that during the process. And there was so much burnt popcorn, I think I ruined the pan. So just something to keep in mind. And you know what, I think it was my sister's pan. So I still am sorry about that. Her and her husband still give me grief about that years later. Oh, and she's finding more tools. So we put a lot of popcorn in there, but it does sound like it's starting to slow down. Adelaide, you're almost up, okay? It's time for the toppings. This is something fun that we do. Not very much air is coming out. Oh, sounds like the popcorn is fading, so I turned the stovetop off. Okay, I'm gonna remove it from the hot burner. There sounds like there's still a few more popping. Adelaide, are you ready?
Yeah.
Okay. Ooh, yeah. Steam. Look at this. She's very excited. Okay. So, this is a lot of popcorn. We're gonna be eating popcorn probably for a couple of days. So probably what I would do would be to take some of this out and put it in a bowl and then do your seasonings, okay? But again, I'm just gonna tell you again, my preferred seasonings for popcorn are salt and nutritional yeast. Do you want a piece of popcorn? Okay, here we go. She likes it without anything.
Hockey.
Yeah, you want to show everybody? Do you like the popcorn? Thanks for watching. Happy graduation.
Hi guys. So as part of your big send-off into adulthood, I'm gonna be showing you how to make a smoothie. It's a very quick, easy thing to do, and you can have it as a snack, you can have it as a pre or post workout meal, and there's really not much to it. So basically what you want is, you want to have 3 or 4 different types of fruit that you like, that you want to mix together. I got some Greek yogurt, fruit juice, and just something
books. If you want to do a vegan version of this, you can replace the yogurt for some almond milk. Maybe you have access to that. A blender, and one of the things that you want to keep in mind is you want to make sure that one of your fruits is frozen. So just that's a little bit of prep that you need to do beforehand. And one of the things that I always use in my smoothies personally is banana, just because it gives it a really good consistency on one hand, and you don't need to add any sugar because banana is already pretty sweet. So let's get to it. So basically, if I was doing this just for one person, I would only add one banana, but since I'm going to be making this for two, I'm going to be adding two. I have a little helper right here. She's also helping me clean up. She's very interested in what I'm doing. So two bananas, and I've got some papaya, but I've already frozen it, so this is my frozen fruit. I'm also going to drop a few bits of frozen banana just to give it a little bit more of a thick consistency. If you don't have a frozen fruit, you can throw in ice, but you want to make sure that your blender can crush ice, because some of them can't and you're just going to ruin your blender. And the reason why you want it to be frozen is because that's what's going to make it thick and not just like a mixed fruit juice. Passion fruit, I already scooped some out to make it easier. So you just want to dump everything into the blender. And the reason why I put the oats in is because it makes it that much healthier and it makes you feel full for a bit longer and much more nutritious. So again, if you're doing this for the first time and you want to measure, maybe just like half a cup, I would think. Yogurt. Again, if you need to measure, for one person, you would be making just one of these for you, but if you're making it for two people, then just double up on that. So I'm just gonna calculate it here. This just as a little bit of extra liquid. If you don't want it as sweet, you can just add water. But I kind of like to add just a little bit of this, that sweet taste that the fruit juice gives it. Alright, let's see how this goes. Actually works. And that's it. Let's stir it up. Nice and thick. there you go. Enjoy.
Hi guys! Today I'm going to teach you a really important life skill. It's how to make a box mac and cheese. This is going to be perfect for you in a pinch at university. It's going to be ready in 10 minutes or less, give you some power to get through your afternoon classes, and it's delicious. Quick public service announcement though, there is no health in this box anywhere. The packaged cheese is packed with chemicals that are not good for you. That being said, 24 boxes of these is what I started my school year with when I went to university, so get ready. This is going to be a good one. Okay, and the first step here is we're going to get a nice medium-sized pot, fill it half full with water, and then bring it to a nice solid boil before bringing your pasta noodles. Make sure you take out the packet of the cheese first, of course. And the water needs to be boiling before you put the noodles in. If you put the noodles in before the water is boiling, you'll ruin everything. And from here, we're just gonna stir pretty often for the next 7 minutes or less. Don't overcook the noodles. Again, you'll ruin your box. It won't be perfect. All right, now you know your noodles are finished when they're soft, but not too soft. And I have a little trick I like to use is to check and see if there's just a little bit of white at the edges. These are looking about perfect. So at this point, we're ready to strain. All right, now the beauty of this meal is that you really only need two ingredients to make it happen, butter and milk. Unfortunately, when I went into my fridge to get the milk out today, there isn't any. So you have some options for improvising. You can use water, which will be a little bit boring. You can use coconut milk, which is what I'm going to do. But ideally, you're going to use your regular milk. That's about it. The box says you can add margarine, but of course we want to make this the most epic white cheddar mac and cheese. So we're going to use real butter, and it says 1/3 cup, but let's go with that. And 1/3 cup of cream or coconut milk. We're actually going to use some cooking cream to really thicken this up today. Another 1/3 cup, so I'm just going to eyeball that here. Wow, that's going to be a thick and creamy mac and cheese, holy. Okay, and then we're just going to mix it all together, get that. Make sure you get the ingredients there while it's still hot so that the butter is going to properly melt in. And once the butter's fully melted, oh yeah, that's smelling good. You can go ahead and add your horrible but delicious packet of cheese. I think we need some water here to maybe. Oh, there's enough moisture with the cream. We're good.
And here are the ingredients for making this simple pasta sauce. We're going to use chopped tomatoes, tomato sauce, a little bit of olive oil to saute vegetables. Those vegetables being small onion, a couple of cloves of garlic, a small zucchini, and a few chopped mushrooms. And finally, we'll season it with a little salt, pepper, and Italian seasoning. The Italian seasoning just being a mixture of basil, oregano, rosemary, and thyme. You can buy already made in the store. And then I'm gonna just cut off the top, cut off the bottom, I'm gonna cut it in half and peel it. Then I'm gonna slice it up. usually thing I do when I'm slicing it, I cut this center bit out because it's a bit bitter. Okay. And to do this, I'm going to do a few horizontal or vertical, depending on which way you hold it. Garlic, we're gonna smash it. And we can pull the peel off. Easier said than done sometimes. And then I'll chop it up. Kind of with the onion, I slice it vertically. I'm going to chop the other direction, make it nice and small. Come here. There it is. Ready to go. Zucchini. I'm going to cut the top and the bottom off. Some people like to call this courgette. Call it Italian squash. So I slice it. I'm going to come back, do some nice quick vertical cuts. Always doing these parallel lines. That's what happens when you're a math teacher. One way you can tell if it's warm enough is the oil coats the bottom of the pan quite nicely. I'm going to put in my onions first so them sizzle nicely. And I'm just going to notice that it's on high. I need to turn it down a little. They're a little too high right now. Been sautéing for a couple of minutes. Now I'm adding a teaspoon and a half of Italian seasoning. And then put in the tomato. Put it on the ground just a little bit. You simmer the sauce for about 20 minutes. This is what a simmer looks like. A few bubbles percolating on top. Okay, I'm going to add a little salt and pepper to it.
So what are you making?
A little bit of ranch sauce.
Excellent. That is for our dinner, correct?
No, it's for the seniors. Of course, they can't taste it, but that's okay. They probably lost their taste buds due to COVID-19.
Oh, well, we'll report how good it is. After dinner tonight.
And there it is.
Hello, IST class of 2020. Congratulations on graduating, even if it is a kind of a weird way. Anyway, Miss Kobe asked me to spend a few minutes teaching you an important life skill. So I thought long and hard about this and decided to teach you something drawing on my cultural heritage. So today, I'm gonna teach you how to make an excellent cup of tea. Particularly useful for those of you going to study in the UK. If you're not going to study in the UK, then sorry for wasting your time. But to be honest, you probably have quite a lot of time on your hands now anyway, so not that sorry. So what will you need? Obviously you need a mug, courtesy of 2019 IST class. You'll need milk, and you'll need a kettle, not tea kettle, like Americans might say, but a kettle, okay? That's for the hot water. So, start off, tea bag. Goes in there, nice. Kettle, I've actually pre-boiled the kettle, but you don't have to do that. But normally you probably won't be making a video as you make a cup of tea. That goes in there. Just fill that right up. Okay. Then you're gonna leave that for like, I mean, jury's out on this one. If you're really gasping, maybe 30 seconds, 1 minute, but people usually say like 2 minutes. That's pretty crazy. So we'll wait up. Becoming delicious, becoming perfect, becoming refreshing. And meanwhile, it's pretty difficult when you've got, hang on, into there and squeeze out a tea bag. Some people put the milk in first. Apparently the queen does that, but the queen can do one, that's mental. So then we put in a little bit of milk. Now, some people just have a little bit. I'm not a big fan of the dairy, so we have a little bit of milk. Again, some people might put in oat milks or nut milks. Again, that's insane. Don't listen to those people. And there you have an excellent cup of tea. Okay, it's best served with a little bit of cake. I made this cake yesterday, literally made this cake. And that's it. In the words of the English playwright Arthur Pinero, where there's tea, there's hope. Good luck, congratulations on graduating. Bye everyone.
Hey there, grade 12s, here to teach you some of the skills I like best about how to survive and make all the friends in university. And I'm gonna show you how to do it with just a bowl, a fork, and a couple other special little things that you might have lying around in your university dorm, because you are going to make so many friends with cupcakes. Now we're gonna make the cupcakes from scratch, because most of the things that you make cupcakes with, you'll probably have in your house anyways, like sugar, flour, eggs, right? You can go out and you can buy an instant cake mix too if you want to, just as easy. We're gonna make the cupcakes from scratch, because it's me, but I am gonna cheat a little bit and we're gonna make the icing from the container. The first thing you're gonna wanna do is find the recipe that you want to use. My chocolate cake recipe, which I know you all love, is actually really easy, and that's what I'm gonna make today. It all goes in one bowl. Find all the stuff you need for the recipe and put it out on your counter so it's there when you need it. Okay, so then you're gonna get your cupcake cups, whatever style you've chosen. Put those in the cupcake pan for however many cupcakes you're planning to make. Then you're gonna just use whatever you have around. It could be a spoon, it could be whatever. I'm just gonna use like a measuring cup, and I'm just gonna scoop out and scoop into sure that they're maybe 3/4 full. Once your oven's preheated and all heated up, all you need to do, put them in and set your timer for however long the recipe says. Okay, so when cupcakes are done, make sure you have something, an oven mitt, a towel, whatever, don't burn yourself, right? You take your cupcakes out of the oven and look how beautiful they are. Let them cool. So for your icing, all you need is a Ziploc bag with a hole cut in the end, and you stick your icing in the bag. We're using Betty Crocker. So you just hold the bag over top of the cupcakes, hold it top tight on top, and just very easily right onto the cupcakes. Just go in a round motion. Once you've got your icing on, you don't need too much for a little pizzazz, maybe just a few little sprinkles. Love you guys, good luck moving forward, and I can't wait to see where you go. Okay, grade 12, you've had a chance to see me make my cupcakes, and you all knew this was coming because it's been a while, but I challenge you all to a bake war. On May 20th, bring your baked goods to Advisory online, and even though we won't be able to taste everyone's, we're sure gonna have a great time seeing what everyone baked. Can't wait to see you!